celebrate Jesus. Let's celebrate Jesus. Let's celebrate Jesus for his love for us. Let's celebrate. Come on, you can do better for Jesus. Let's celebrate him. Let's celebrate him. We sing a song, it paid the debt that we cannot pay. We owe the debt that we cannot pay. Can choir help us?
He paid the debt. He did not owe.
For the Father, God has redeemed this one from every curse of the law. Father, I thank you. This one is no more under curses. This one is have been blessed, and this one has been redeemed from all curses. Begin to praise God in the name of Jesus. Praise God for that person. If you fail in one, according to the law, you fail in all. But Jesus has come to redeem us from the curse and curses of the law. Thank God for saving us from curses. Thank God for saving us from the curses of the law. Father, we thank you. Father, we worship you. Thank you for saving my sister. Thank you for saving my brother. For saving everyone of us from the curses of the law. Father, we thank you. Father, we worship you. Father, we adore you. For redeeming us, O Lord. For saving us from the curses of the law. May your name alone be glorified. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' anointed name, we are praised.
Amen.
So you are going to pray one or two more prayers with that person. If there's any cause or causes still remaining in the life of this one, today is the last resurrection Sunday, and Jesus has already paid the price to redeem you from all causes. If there's any cause from your father's house or mother's house that could still be affecting your destiny, because Jesus has redeemed you from it, they are not permitted in your life again. So I command every cause be broken. Begin to pray in the name of Jesus. Fresh in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you, Father. Bless
blessed be your holy name, O Lord. Amen. In Jesus' anointed name, we are praying.
Amen.
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 Let's be seated in His presence. God will bless you all in Jesus' name.
Amen.
I know it's been a wonderful weekend, a Valentine weekend. Amen.
Amen.
And Jesus Christ is the ultimate Valentine, for His love is unrivaled. Amen.
Amen.
And it's not a coincidence that we are talking about love, the fulfillment of the law today. Let's go to the book of Romans. Book of Romans chapter 13, where the text is being taken. Romans chapter 13 from verse 8. Bible says, owe no one anything except to love one another. For he who loves another has fulfilled the law. Verse 9. For the commandment, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not bear false witness, you shall not covet, and if there's any other commandment, are all summed up in this saying, namely, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. The last verse, verse 10. Love does no harm to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfillment of the law. Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
In the Garden of Eden, God commanded Adam, Genesis chapter 2, from verse 15, that eat everything in this garden, but one thing, one of those fruits, one of those trees, you must not eat anything from it. He ate it, and since that day, trouble, calamity, all sorts of things have come into the world. He was in fellowship with God at all times. He was in tune with God at all times. The language of love was the language between him and God. Adam knew no hatred. He knew no, any malady. He knew no any rebellion. Not until sin came. Not until he ate the fruit. Since that time, humanity needed to be cautioned. Humanity needed to be put under control. No wonder God introduced the law. Imagine a state, imagine a country, imagine a garden without law. What's going to happen? People will just run riot. People will just do whatever they like. People will have no control, no sense of judgment. Then God introduced the law to caution people so that people will not go haywire. Because the Adamic nature in human being has been set loose. No wonder we saw the first thing that was done. Cain killed Abel. Since that time, all sorts of things have been happening, all sorts of things. But to caution human beings, to make sure that human beings do not go haywire, then God set law. So what are the purposes of law? Why did God introduce the law? Law in the Old Testament, we have about 613 of them. Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
613 laws, both Mosaic laws and Levitical laws, including the Ten Commandments. All of them, 613 altogether. And if you don't keep all these laws, if you break any one of them, it's a curse. There will be judgment, there will be curses. And the way of salvation then is to keep all the laws. Then they can be saved. But thank God for Jesus. Now let's go to the book of Galatians. Let me just briefly mention the purpose of the law before we move on. Galatians chapter 3, verse 24. As I've said, the Adamic nature in human beings has been set loose because of the fall. Human beings have to be checked. And no wonder God introduced the law, so that when He brought the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, as soon as He brought them out from the land of bondage, He gave them law. In the book of Exodus, Exodus chapter 20, from verses 1 to 15 or so, He gave them laws to check them. He gave them laws to bring them under control. Now, let's talk about the purpose of the law, number one. The purpose of the law, number one, is to lead us to Christ. Galatians 3:24. Galatians 3:24 says, wherefore, the law was a schoolmaster. Because human beings have been set loose, Adamic nature has been set loose, has to be under control. Assuming there is no law, traffic law, a lot of people will be running 120, 150. Anyhow, you can park anywhere. So laws are there to control people, to checkmate people. Now, Bible says, wherefore the Lord was our schoolmaster to lead us or to bring us unto Christ, that we might be justified by faith. So one of the purposes of the law is to lead us to Christ. Before Jesus Christ came, he was a schoolmaster to lead us. The schoolmaster is to lead you, to guide you into the truth, to lead you into the truth, and it was there to lead us. Number two, in the book of Romans chapter 3, verses 19 and 20, law was given so that there can be accountability of sin. Law hold us accountable for our sin. As when there is no law, imagine on the road, no traffic law, and you run 150, 200, and the policeman stops you. Say, ah, why are you stopping me? I'm running 120 now, 200. But no law. But he says, the law is 70, and you are making 120. Therefore, you have broken the law. As when there is no law, what's going to happen? So law is given so that we can be held accountable for our sin. Let's go to Romans chapter 3, verses 19 and 20. Yes? If you are there, you can help me to read. Romans 3, 19 and 20. It says, now we know that whatever the law says, it says to those who are under the law, that every mouth might be stopped, and the word may become guilty before God. Verse 20. Therefore, by the deeds of the law, no flesh will be justified in his sight. By the law is the knowledge of sin. In other words, law brings about the knowledge of sin. And doing, as I've said earlier, no traffic law, there's no cause for you to break the law because no law. So law was introduced so that we can have the knowledge of sin. Let's go to Romans chapter 7, verse 7 as well. It mentions a similar thing. He says, what shall we say then? Is the law sin? Certainly not. On the contrary, I would not have known sin except through the law. For I would not have known covetousness unless the law said, you shall not covet. In other words, law was given unto us so that we can know, have the knowledge of sin, and be accountable for our sins. Number three, law, when I talk about law, I'm talking of the laws, the Mosaic law, the Levitical law, the same, all the laws in the Old Testament, as I've said, there are 613 altogether. Not only just 10 commandments, altogether. Now, all these laws are shadow. Let's go to Hebrews chapter 10, verse 1. All these laws are shadow of the good things that are coming. All these things are the shadow. The reality, which is Jesus, is yet to be to surface. The reality, which is Jesus, is yet to come to reality. So there are shadows. The Bible says, chapter 10, verse 1 says, for the law, having a shadow of good things to come. My shadow is not my real person. It's not a shadow of me. I'm different from my shadow. I mean, shadow is here, but portray me, but it's not actually me. If you stand on my shadow, no problem. But if you stand upon me, I will feel the pain. Shout hallelujah. Amen. So all the law in the Old Testament, Bible says, for the law having a shadow of good things to come, and not the very image of the things, can never, with those sacrifices which they offered year by year continually, make the commands thereunto perfect. In other words, there are shadows of things to come. Shadows means the reality is around the corner. But these ones, it's just a way, like a typology of the reality to come. That if you sin, kill cow, kill dove for the remission of your sin, then they will shed the blood. The blood is not taking away their sin. The blood is only covering their sins. It's a shadow. So but when we come to Jesus, the blood of Jesus is blotting out our sin. It's cleansing our sin. It's wiping off our sin. So it's a way, it's a shadow that is forthcoming. Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Number four. Law set a standard of holiness. Law set a standard of holiness. As soon as the children of Israel came out of Egypt, the Bible says to us in the book of Exodus chapter 19, verse 10, that he gave them, he said, you are holy nation unto me. Let's go to Exodus chapter 19 from verse 5. Exodus 19, verse 5. Now, say, now therefore, if you will obey my voice indeed and keep my covenant, then ye shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all the people, for all the earth is mine. Verse 6. And ye shall be unto me a kingdom of priests and an holy nation. This sounds like 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. Exactly. It's a way to mark them, to separate them, that you are unique people. I am holy, and you are my children. I want you to have my nature. I want you to be holy. I want you to be righteous as mine. And I'm giving you commandment and law that is different from the people of the world that are worshiping idols. This one are holy commandments for you to follow in my step. Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So, laws number 5. But that notwithstanding, now let's go to Galatians chapter 2. I want us to go to Galatians chapter 2. Let's read verse 3, verse 16. And he said that to show that we could never. God gave them a standard of holiness to meet. That you are peculiar people unto me. I am holy. This is my standard. God knew that they cannot meet that standard. But that standard will make them to be unique. Will make them to be separate from the people of the world. Bible says in the book of Galatians chapter 2 verse 16. That knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but by faith of Jesus Christ. Even we that have believed in Jesus Christ, that we might. Even we have believed in Jesus, that we might. Look, verse 17. Yes. That, but if while we seek to be justified by Christ, we ourselves also are found sinners, as therefore Christ is the minister of sin. God shout hallelujah. So, you know what I'm trying to say, that God gave them the standard of holiness. But God knew that they cannot keep that standard. But it is the standard that God wanted to reach. The standard of God has never changed and can never change. The standard of God is holy. The standard of God is righteous. The standard of God is pure. And God gave them the law so that they will struggle to meet that standard. And when they fail to meet that standard, he's using all those ones to lead them, to Christ. We shall see in the minute. Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Now, number 5. Lord set Israel apart as a unique nation to all nations, which I mentioned before, Exodus chapter 19. It made them to be set apart. Most of the nations around them at the time were worshiping idols. They have no unique laws that were given to the Israelites. So laws were given to them that you guys, you people, you are unique. Follow my commandment, follow my ways, my way of uniqueness, so to separate them. Number 6, through the sacrifice and offering for the nation of Israel. If you read Leviticus chapter 1 to 7, it tells you about the way of forgiveness. You must kill this. If you do this, you must do that. If you do this, you must do that. So law were given to them, especially the ceremonial laws, that whatever you do that is wrong, this is what you should do as solution, the way out of your trouble, the way out of sin, the way out of your consequences. Shout hallelujah. Then the last one, Lord provide a way of worship through the yearly feast. If you read the whole book of Leviticus chapter 23, the way to worship, Bible says in the New Testament, those who worship them was worshiping in what? In spirit and what? And in. But in the Old Testament, the way they were worshiping God is different. They were worshiping God the way God has already written in his law. So these are the purposes of the law. But now, I want you to know that all these laws, 613 as they were weak. They couldn't make anybody holy. Let's go to the book of Hebrews. Hebrews now, Hebrews chapter 7, verses 18 and 19. The weakness of the law. The laws were given for these purposes. For the Israelites, but most especially for we, the Israelites in the spirit, the Lord were given for us to lead us to Christ. For us to try to meet the standard that we couldn't meet the standard and say, now, what can I do? Don't forget the book of Romans chapter 7. from verses 15, 19 to 20 and the rest. But God was citing an example of somebody who was living under the law. He said the good that he really wants to do, he couldn't do it. The evil that he doesn't want to do was what he was practicing. The standard is holy. The standard is here. And anyone under the law tried to keep that standard. And when they failed to keep that standard, they will say in verse 24, Romans chapter 7, verse 24, say, oh, wretched man I am. Who is going to help me out? Shout hallelujah. And when they cry, oh, wretched man that I am, who is going to help me out? Then the solution is in Romans chapter 8, from verse 1, through the help of the Holy Spirit. By saying no more condemnation for everyone that is in Christ, that works according to the Spirit and not according to the flesh. Shout hallelujah.
Amen.
So the law is weak. Romans chapter 7, verse 18 says, for there is verily a disannulling for the commandment, going before the witness and unprofitable thereof. Verse 19. For the law made nothing perfect. Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
All this is from 13. Laws could not make anyone perfect, but the bringing in of a better hope did, by which we draw near to God. In other words, the law could not make anyone perfect, but the bringing in of a better hope, who is that better hope? Jesus is the only one that can make anyone perfect. The laws cannot make one perfect. The Bible says, by the deeds of the law, no one can be justified. Let's go back to Galatians now. Galatians chapter 2. Let's read again. Galatians chapter 2, let's read verse 16. The deeds of the law, God says, knowing that a man is not justified, can never be justified, can never be made righteous, can never be. When we are talking justification, is a legal term. When you appear in the law court and they say, okay, go, you are discharged, click on and acquitted. It's a legal term. Before you can be discharged and and declare guiltless before God, before you can be justified as we have never sinned, knowing that the man is not justified by the works of the law, but by what? By faith of Jesus Christ. Even we that have believed in Christ. Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Law is weak, cannot make anyone righteous. It can only make you to be conscious of sin, but cannot make you righteous. Number two, law is a bondage. Put people under bondage. In the book of Romans, let's go to Romans. I want us to read now Romans chapter 7 from verse 1. Law, people put people under bondage. Put everyone under bondage. Romans chapter 7 from verse 1. And Apostle Paul was using this one. He was using the natural to explain the spiritual. He was using relationship between man and woman to explain the relationship between God and man, between law and man. Now, look at this. Say, know ye not, brethren, for I speak to them that know the law. So, Romans chapter 7 is about people who walk under the law. So, when you are saying, Apostle Paul said, the good you want to, it's not Apostle Paul who is saying that. It's not through genuine born again of Apostle Paul. It's people working under the law that passage is referring to. The good that they wish to do, they have no grace and the power to do it. Shout hallelujah. Now, I said, know ye not, brethren, therefore I speak to them that know the law, how the law hath dominion over a man as long as he liveth. Verse 2. For the woman, can I have two of you? Please come. Two of you. Let's demonstrate this so we can see the bondage of the law and we can find what you have done for us. Now, this is the husband and this is the wife. This one now is married to law. This is law, the husband. And this one is married to law. So we see now. Now, for the woman which had an husband, she has an husband now, which is this one, is bound by the law to her husband. So long as Mr. Law is still alive. But if the husband, if Mr. Law is dead, but if the husband is dead, she is loosed from the law of what? Of her husband. Verse 3. Now, he used his physical, the natural to explain the spiritual. He said, so then, while her husband liveth, while Mr. Law still lives, she be married to another. If this one should go down, the wife should go and marry another, she shall be called adulteress. But if her husband, Mr. Law, dies, she's what? She's free from the law. So that she's no more, she's not adulteress. Though she be married to what? To another. Now, verse 4. Wherefore, my brethren, now he's talking to us now. Wherefore, my brethren, ye also become dead to the law by the body of Christ. Yes, that ye should be married to another, even to him who is raised. Now, I need the third person. Come, Ashley, come. This is Mr. Law. And this one is married to Mr. Law. And now, this is Jesus now. This is Jesus now. So, as long as this one is still alive, Mr. Law is still alive. If this one should come to Jesus, it's what? Adulteress. Now, but if Mr. Law is dead, then this one is free to marry Jesus. Now, he said, wherefore, my brethren, ye also have become dead to the law. Because the law, through Jesus, is abandoned to the law by the body of Christ, that ye should marry to another, even to him who is raised from what? From the dead, which will bring forth fruit unto God. In other words, Jesus Christ died in the place of Mr. Law. So for Mrs. Law, this is Mrs. Law. Jesus Christ died in death for Mrs. Law. So Mrs. Law could be free to marry Jesus. Now, verse 5. For when we were in the flesh, when we were still married to Mr. Law, the motions of sin which were by the law did work in our member to bring forth fruit unto death. In other words, when we were married to Mr. Law, we were pursuing law. We were pursuing righteousness that come from the law. We were walking in the flesh. We were doing all sorts of things. Now, verse 6. But now, say you are, I am delivered.
I am delivered.
But now we are delivered from what? From the law. That being dead, wherein we were held. We were dead. Mr. Law is dead. We should serve in newness of the spirit, not in oldness of the letter of Mr. Law anymore. Verse 7 now. What shall we say then? Is the law sin? God forbid. Nay, I have not known spirit. Then we mention the purpose of the law. Simple thing, children of God, we were married to Mr. Law. And for us to be free from Mr. Law, somebody which have to die for Mrs. Law to be free. And that one died. Not only died, he resurrected. Because if somebody died in the place of Mrs. Law, if he didn't resurrect, of course, it's gone. But this one died, Mr. Jesus died and resurrected. He died for Mrs. Law to be free. Then he came back the third day to come back and marry Mrs. Law. Come on, shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Come on, shout hallelujah. Go back.
Hallelujah.
Tell the next person, that's my story. We were married to Mrs. Law. And the way out is for somebody to, and Mr. Law says, if you sin, you must be die. If you, and somebody came and what? Died. He didn't die alone, he resurrected. And when he died, he paid the penalty for Mrs. Law. Then he resurrected now to marry Mrs. Law. And no more we are free from the law. Come on, shout hallelujah. Come on, celebrate Jesus. Come on, celebrate Jesus, celebrate Jesus, celebrate Jesus. Celebrate Jesus. This is exactly what Jehovah did for us, children of God. And now having done all this, when we are saying, now let's go back to the chapter that we are considering. Romans chapter 13. We are still coming. It's a balanced topic that we are still coming. Romans chapter 13 now. Let's go to verse 10. To his neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfillment of what? Of love. Now, what do we mean by that? Number one, Jesus fulfilled the law for us because of his agape love for us. Number two, by walking in love, we are practicing what the law emphasized. What is love emphasized? Love emphasized two things. Love God and love your neighbor. For example, 10 commandments I was given. The first 4 commandments was to love God with all our heart, with all our mind. The remaining 6 are for us to love one another. Now, when those ten, for example, is broken into two, love God and love one another. Now, number three, love is the nature of God. And it is our own nature too, because we are His sons. I won't believe Jesus as our Lord and Savior, children of God. We well know 2 Corinthians chapter 5 verse 17. What is it? Whoever that is in Christ is what? Is a new creation. Behold, all things are what? All things have become new. This and that. Now, the new nature that we are, don't forget, we have read. Let's go back to Romans chapter 7 now. Romans chapter 7 verse 6. I won't believe Jesus as our Lord and Savior. We have been given answers. But now, we are delivered from the law. That being dead, wherein we were held, that we should serve. What is it? How do we serve now? In the newness of the Spirit. What is that newness of the Spirit? Love. We should serve in the newness of the Spirit and not in oldness of what? Of the letter. I want to accept that Jesus as our Lord and Savior now. And you are walking in love. Unconsciously, you are keeping the whole law. Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
When you are walking in love, you are walking in the new way that God has already earmarked in the New Testament. The new way that God has earmarked in the New Testament is the law of love. And when you are walking in the law of love, you are keeping all the laws of the Old Testament. Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Now, what do we mean by love is the fulfillment of the law. Number four. Love wasn't the original intention of God. It was the fall of man that led to it. It wasn't the intention of God. As I've told you, because of the fall, our Adamic nature became erratic and need to be tempered, need to be controlled. Then the love was introduced. Now, when you are now walking in love, the original nature, the original walking between Adam and God before, what binded them together before was what? Love. So now when we are now walking in love, we are walking in our original plan and purpose and intention of God for our lives. Shout hallelujah.
Amen.
Number five, love should be the motivation behind all what we are doing. I asked you earlier, why are you worshiping God? Why are you obeying God? Is it to make heaven? Is it to get the blessing of God? The purpose of you doing whatever you are doing is to glorify and to honor God.
Amen.
When your purpose is to glorify and to honor your Father, children of God, everything will be easy. But if your purpose of obeying God is because you want to get blessing, and the blessing does not forthcome, you will backslide. That will not be our portion in Jesus' name.
Amen.
If the purpose of worshiping God and serving God and doing everything is because of what you can gain or get from Him, if he doesn't release it in time, what's going to happen? But if your purpose is to honor your God, if he cares of what you are going to, children of God, you keep on being on fire for him. If your purpose is to honor and to glorify your God, the Bible says in the book of Matthew chapter 5, from verse 13, he says, you are the salt and the light of the world. He says, now we should let our light shine so that our Father will be glorified. The purpose of us serving God, the purpose of you worshiping God, the purpose of you doing everything you are doing is to make sure that your Father is glorified. He said, now go to verse 15. Verse 15. Neither do men light a candle and put under the bushel, but a candle and a given light. Now verse 16 now. Let your light so shine before men that they may see how you will shine by good works. By doing good works, then and your Father will be glorified. This is the purpose. Because of love, because unconditional love that God Jesus Christ bestowed upon us is unconditional love. But when you say you want to love God because of what you can get from Him, you are repaying agape love with filial love. So let our mentality change that from today, that the purpose of being worshiping God, serving God, honoring God is what? To honor and to glorify my Father. Now, practical love demonstrated by Jesus. I mentioned about four or five here. Number one, in the book of John, let's go to John chapter chapter 8. Let's learn from this practical way. As I told you, all the laws must be kept for us to please God. And we cannot keep all the laws. No wonder Jesus came to fulfill all the laws. Now let's go to Matthew again. Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5, read from there. Let's go from verse 15. No. Matthew chapter 5. Go to verse 17.
Do not think that I came to destroy the law.
Do not think I have come to destroy all the laws. Yes?
All the prophets.
All the laws and the prophets. Yes?
I did not come to destroy
them. He said, I did not come to destroy all of them, but he came to fulfill them for you and for me. Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Yes?
But to fulfill.
But to fulfill.
For surely I say to you.
For surely I say to you.
Till heaven and earth pass away.
Yes?
One jot or one title will by no means pass from the law till all is fulfilled.
God bless you, man. Now let's go to Galatians chapter 3. Galatians chapter 3, let's read verse 10. Galatians chapter 3, verse 10. If you fail in one of these laws, it's a curse. If you fail in one of these laws, it's trouble. Now, Bible says, for as many as are under the law, works of the law, are under the curse. For it is written, curse is everyone that continue not in all. You must keep all of them. But Jesus came to keep all the laws for you. So that the only thing God wants us to do now is to put our faith in Jesus who has kept everything for us. Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
God is everyone that continue not in all the things which are written in the book of the law to do them all. Now let's go to James now. James chapter 2 verse 10. James 2 10 says, if you break one of those laws, you are broken all. But thank God for Jesus who came to keep all. Now, for whosoever shall keep the whole law, 612 out of 613, and yet offend in one point, he is guilty of the remaining 613. So how can we be saved? Come and say, thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Jesus Christ came, he was motivated by love to keep all the laws for us. Matthew 5:17, to fulfill all the laws. What we just need to do as New Testament believers is to put our faith in that Jesus. And God will see you as if we have kept all the laws as well.
Amen.
Bible says in the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 5 verse 21, that he who knew no sin has been made sin for us, so that we can become the righteousness of God in him. He said, for he had made him, who? Jesus, to be what? Sin for us. Who knew no sin, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. So who are you now? Righteousness of God. He has taken away the sin. He has fulfilled all the laws. All the causes of the law, they are no more binding on you anymore. Now, we have become the righteousness of God. Now, let's see the demonstration, some of the way Jesus had demonstrated this. Now, John chapter 8, they caught a woman in an adultery. The Pharisees came and said, yes, we really caught her, even in the act of it. And then now, the Lord said, we should stone her to death. That's the law. And now they said, Jesus, what do you say? He stood down. And then, who among you have never sinned at all should first of all cast the stone? Right from the pastor, the evangelist, the deaconess, the deacons, every one of us, one by one, they were walking out. Then when they woke up, I said, yes. Not only the pastor could stone you. Okay, me too. I don't condemn you. Go and walk. Sin no more. Love will make you to forgive others. Irregardless, love by love, an eye for an eye. You did this to me, you slap me, I must slap you. But love will say, go, I let you go. Again, let's go to Matthew 14:14. Love, the demonstration of love of Jesus. Matthew 14, let's read verse 14 to 16. And Jesus went forth and saw a great multitude. A great multitude came and moved with compassion towards them. Love will make you to pray to heal people. We think love is to do good alone. The Bible says was moved with compassion, the element of love. The first thing he did was what? He healed the sick. For you to pray, lay hands upon the sick is an act of love. Okay, what will you do for someone? How will you show love? If somebody is hungry, what will you do? God bless you, and you will be filled. What will you do? You feed them. Now, if somebody is in pain, what will you need to do? To pray for their relief. Now, that's 15, verse 15. He showed love by healing them. Now, verse 15. And when it was evening, his disciples came to him, and the desert place, and the time is now past. They came to Jesus and said, send the multitude away. They may go into the village and eat, because no food here. The disciples came, come on, say. But Jesus had said the next verse, he said, Jesus said, do not let them go away. Give them something to eat. Love, Jesus had demonstrated love by setting the people that are supposed to be killed, some people that are supposed to be stoned, by setting her free. No matter maybe what the people might have done to you that warrant death or anything, by setting them free is love. By healing the sick is love. By giving them what to eat, by feeding people, is love. These are the way Jesus demonstrated his own love. Now, Luke chapter 10, the Good Samaritan. The Good Samaritan, the pastor was coming, saw a Good Samaritan that was about to die. He said, I must not lead to church. He ran, he went. Then another one came. The teachers came. They saw him. They said, no, if I touch him, I'll be unclean. Let. Bible says, someone came, a Good Samaritan, saw him, carried him and took him into the inn. That's act of love. Now, your neighbor, who is your neighbor? Anyone that will have the grace to do good to is your neighbor. Your neighbor starts from your wife, your children, the people on your left and your right side, in your house, your friends, even to your enemy. Jesus was showing them that even you must love your enemy. The Samaritans are the enemies of the Jews. When these people of the Jews, when the Jewish people, the Jewish leaders saw this Samaritan, they neglected her, they neglected him. But Jesus Christ showed love. He said that to told us that we should show love, even to our enemies. You know that these people are the ones doing evil against you, saying this, doing that, backbiting or going against you. But love is for what? To still do good towards them. Jesus Christ demonstrated this. And children of God, I will close with this. Let's go to book of Luke. Luke chapter 9, verses 54 to 56. Apostle John, and Jesus, they wanted to go to a Samaritan village. And they said to them, you are not going to pass through this place. So. And John is one of the golden sons of Guanaji. That is the children of thunder. These are furious and fire, on fire people. Say, Jesus, can we call fire from heaven like Elijah did to consume the old village? Jesus says, you don't know the spirit that is in you. You think the Old Testament, a lot of us, we are in the New Testament, but we are operating with the Old Testament mentality. He said, don't you know the spirit that is in you? Look, verse 54. And when the disciples, James and John, the sons of Barnabas, saw this, they said, Lord, without that we command fire to come down from heaven and consume them as Elijah did. What did he say? Verse 55. But he turned and rebuked them and said, ye not know what manner of spirit you are of. Children of God, you too, having accepted you as a Lord and Savior, the spirit of God that is in you is the spirit of love. Not to destroy people, but to not to harm people, but to edify others, to lift up others. This was Apostle John. Now, I deliberately brought this out. Now, if you now go to 1 John, 2 as 1 John, this man, son of Barnabas, that wanted to call fire here, he was not an apostle of love. When God changed his life, when God remolded his life, he became an apostle of John of love. Throughout the fourth book of 1 John, 2 John, 3 John, Apostle John was writing about what? Love. You can read a lot of them. He said, love does not, if you look at 1 John chapter 2, 10 to 11, love does not hate. 1 John 2, 15 to 17, love not the world. 1 John 3, 10 to 15. Love does not hate again. Then 1 John 3:16 to 18. Love, he said, show your love. If you say you love God and you don't practicalize your love is meaningless. He was a man that wanted to call fire before. But when God changed his life, he was preaching and talking about love. Children of God, should we now say love is useless? No. Let's go, let's be wrapped up with this. Let's go to the book of John. John chapter 13, let's read verse 13. Actually, before that, let's go to the book of Matthew. Matthew 24, verse 12. Does that mean now that having accepted you as my Lord and Savior, I'm not under the law? Yes. You are not under the law for salvation. By you keeping all the laws, will not lead to salvation. Shout hallelujah. Amen. Anyway, you cannot even keep them. It's not possible. Amen. Now, but you now keeping the laws, for example, the law, having accepted you as a Lord and Savior, it hasn't changed that if you take something that doesn't belong to you, you are still a thief. Abi?
Yes.
If you sleep with another woman that is not yours, you are still an adulterer. But why I'm now keeping all those things is not because I don't want to be caught. It's because I love God. It's because I want to honor God. The purpose of us keeping law now is to honor God. Not because if I don't steal, if they catch me and they will say, hey, Pastor Lotiwo. No. It's because I love God. It's because I want to honor my God. That's the purpose of keeping the law now. Do you understand this?
Yes.
He said, and because iniquity shall abound, love of many shall what? What? When there is lawlessness, it will affect our love. Law is still, law are still available. You are no more under the law that will lead to righteousness, that will lead to salvation. You keep the law to honor your Father. Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
A lot of people will say, hey, I'm no more under the law. Then lawlessness is no excuse. If you keep on walking in lawlessness, God will chastise you. You know you are still his son, but he will still chastise you. But to avoid God's chastisement, he's chastising us, not punishment, but to correct us. But why do I need to witness God's correction when I can be free? Children of God, love is the fulfillment of God. Shall we rise on our feet? Come on, let's rise on our feet. Come on, give it to Jesus. Give it to Jesus. Give it to Jesus. Give it to Jesus. If you want to be saved, children of God, our salvation hinges on us accepting Jesus Christ, putting our trust on Jesus completely. Then we'll be saved. But if you are keeping the law for your purpose is to make heaven, children of God, you cannot keep all the laws. And that will be a disaster. But the purpose of you keeping the laws is to glorify your God. To honor your Father. That's the purpose. And now by you now walking in love, children of God, love will not. Let's go back to that Romans chapter 13 from verse 10. Romans 13 from verse 10. Then we pray. Romans 13 from verse 10. Love worketh no ill. If I love you, I will do to you what I want you to do to me. Love worketh no ill to his neighbor. In other words, if you love somebody, you will not do evil to that person. Therefore, love is the fulfillment of the law. Verse 11. And that knowing the time, that now is high time, I wake out of sleep, for the now is the time of salvation. Yes? No. Verse 12. You see Romans we are reading?
Yes.
Now, go back down to verse, go back now. Go back from verse 8. Owe no man anything but to love one another. For he that love hath fulfilled the law. By walking in love, you are keeping all the laws unconsciously. Verse 9. things: thou shalt not commit adultery, thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not bear false witness, thou shalt not covet. If there's any other commandment, it is briefly commended in this saying: thou shalt love thy neighbor. If you love your neighbor as yourself, children of God, you will not steal from them, you will not bear false witness, you will not covet, you will not commit adultery, you will not. By walking in this, we are keeping the law. The law of the New Testament now, John chapter 13, let's round up with that. John 13, verse 34. Jesus Christ now said, not only love your neighbor as yourself, but love your neighbor, love everyone as I have loved you. He says, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another as what? Because some people don't love themselves. So if I say love you, love me as you love yourself. Out of the way I love myself would be, I love to take alcohol or cigarette. And when you come to visit me, I offer you. I'm showing love to you too. But according to this, would Jesus offer me cigarette?
No.
Would Jesus offer me cocaine?
No.
Would he offer me alcohol?
No.
Amen. So a new commandment I give unto you, that you love one another as above. Lord, help me to love you and to love one another. Let's begin to pray. Help me, Lord, to love you and to love one another unconditionally. Lord, help me to love you and to love others unconditionally as you have loved me. Help me, Lord, help me, Lord, help me, Lord, help me, Lord, to love you as I have loved others unconditionally. Help me, Lord. Help me, Holy Spirit. In Jesus' mighty name we are prayed.
Amen.
The final prayer, let's go to Romans chapter 5, verse 5. God is not asking us to do what He has not given us the grace to do. Now we are going to pray with your prayer partner. Romans chapter 8, chapter 5, verse 8. The love of God has been shed abroad in our heart. In other words, the love of God has been released into our heart. God is not asking you to love without giving you the ability to love. He has done it. He said, and hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is for shed abroad. In other words, has been poured. The love of God has been poured in our heart by what? By the Holy Spirit, which is what? Given unto us. Having accepted Jesus as the Lord and Savior, you have the Spirit of God in you. And you have the nature of love. What we just need to do is to work in our new nature. He has, you see, look at this, it's past tense. So, because the love of God is what? Shed abroad. His past tense has been released. Some translators say, have been given unto us. Shed abroad, like put ink inside water. You know, it's going to what? Mix. The same thing. The love of God has been shed in our heart. Has been spread in our heart. What we just need to do is to let it out. To let it out. So the grace, O Lord God, for this one to walk in his new nature. The nature that you have now is the nature of love. The grace for this one to submit to the Holy Spirit and to walk in love at all times, release unto this one. Oh, yeah, begin to pray in the name of Jesus.